Brady, I want to tell you about a lovely puzzle that was invented by two undergraduates at Michigan State. They call it the Stepping Stones puzzle. And it goes like this. You've got a chessboard. It's infinite. And you've got a certain number of brown stones that are worth 1 point each. The puzzle is you can put down the brown stones anywhere you want. Say you've got four brown stones. That's fixed. You put down your four brown stones, and then you add the white stones. The white stones are numbered 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. There's one of each value. And you can only put down a stone labeled 2 if the sum of its eight neighbors, the sum of the eight neighbors of that square, is 2. Well, you can put the 2 here because it's got two neighboring squares of value 1, and 1 plus 1 is 2. So 2 is legal. And having put the 2 there, we could, if we wanted, put a 3 here, because there's a 1 and a 2. We could have put the 2 here also, instead of putting it there. We could not have put it here, because the sum of these stones around it, namely this, this, and this, are 3. So we could only put a 3 there, but we can't put a 3 there until we've placed the 2 stone. We've got to place the stones in order. And the puzzle is, for a given number of brown stones that you start with, like here is 4, how many white stones can you put down? What's the highest number you can get to? So let me do it with 2.
2 browns.
2 browns, exactly. We're going to do it with 2 browns. And we're going to work out, if n is 1, you can't do anything. You can only get 1. So the answer, I'll call it A of n. If n is 2, how far can we get? Well, let's try it. I'm going to start off by putting the 2 brown stones worth 1 point each, put them there. And now there's a unique place to get it to place the 2, which is between them. I can put it there because 1 plus 1 is 2. Now I can put down the 3, and I could put the 3, I could put it there, or there, or there, or there. But without loss of generality, as we say, I will put it there. So now we have to find a place to put the 4. Well, I could put it here, because the 1 and 3 makes 4. But it's a little better to put the 4 here, because then this frees up this square for the 5. We've got to put the 5 somewhere. We've got to make a place for the 5. So I'm going to put the 5 there. And it's legal, because it's got two neighbors, 1 and 4. Now, what about the 6? Well, there's a choice. We could put the 6 here. No, I can't put it there, because that's got neighbor 5, 4, and 1. I could only put a 10 there. Aha. You've got to put them in order. Yes. You've got to build your way up.
So it's not what's the highest value can I get on the board. It's what's the highest value I can get on the board, building in order.
Building in order. Yes. It's like climbing a mountain. You've got to work your way up.
Well, I can see where you can put a 6.
Here, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. 6. It's legal because we got a 1, a 2, and a 3. Makes a 6. We could have put it there too, but I like putting it here.
Does that not now invalidate the 3? The three remains valid.
The 3 remains valid because when it was built, its neighbors added up to 3. And that's fine. Yeah. And then we can use it to build up other things. Yes. All right, 7. Where are we going to put 7? I'd like to put the 7 here, because it's got neighbors 1 and 6, so that works. Now, what about the 8? How about here? Because then we've got the 1, a 4, and a 3, adding up to 8. Now, what about the 9? Well, here would be a good place for the 9. But that looks promising, because I can see where to put the 10. The 10 can go here, because we've got a 4 and a 5 and a 1. Okay, now I think it'll be easy now because we continue that thread. We'll put an 11 there. Now the 12, there's going to be a clever place to put the 12 here. The 12 is a bit of a nuisance because we really want to get down to using the 13 and the 14. We have to, so to speak, place the 12 in a way that won't interrupt us, because you can see that we have a 13 square here, the 6 and the 7. And now we've got a 1, 6 and a 7, so we can put the 14 there. And we can put the 15 there with the 1 and the 14, and we can put the 16 here. Now, I carefully provided stones labeled through 16 because I knew that 16 was the best we could hope to do. The two undergraduates who came up with this puzzle worked this out. They proved that you can't do better than 16 with 2 starting stones.
Because you could put the starting stones in different positions, but that's the optimal position to put them in. Is that where you place? Right.
Yes, yes. What makes this an interesting challenge is that, in fact, you could put the starting stones anywhere you want in the whole world. So if you were writing a program to search for this, you could say for, you know, X1 from minus infinity to infinity from, but of course you don't do that. You say without loss of generality, we can put the first stone there. And then there's really only one good place for the second stone. But then the number of possibilities increases. Initially, it's an impossible sounding problem. But in the end, we can do pretty well. So that's the solution for with two starting stones. All right. So, and it's 16. And we know a few more terms. So we actually know only six terms. And the six is 60. And three is 28. Four is 38. And five is 49. That's all we know. We don't know seven. No one has been able to work it out. And maybe it's because nobody has really tried hard.
Do we know the stone configuration for 3, 4, 5 and 6? We obviously do.
We know one, yes. It's not necessarily unique. Here, for example, are the configurations for four stones. You put the starting stones, the brown stones, in these places, and then you work it out, and eventually you can get up to 38 there. And with six starting stones, that's the starting pattern, and you can get to 60. Now, one thing I was expecting you to ask me, Brady, is how do you know it's finite? Maybe if you're really clever, you can put down the 2 and the 3 and the 4 and 5 and go around in a spiral and get very large numbers. Well, that's not possible, and I will prove it. I can also give you a lower bound. I can show you that you can do at least this well. And this is a construction of Andrew Howroyd. Look at this. Look at this construction. We're going to put down a brown stone here, leave a gap there, and put a 1 here. These are the two brown stones. And then we can put a 2 here. And then we can put a 3, a 4, a 5, and a 6 there. And then he said, let me have pre-placed a 1 here. If we do that, then we can put a 7 here, and then we can put an 8, and a 9, and a 10, and an 11 there. Very cunning. And then we're going to put a 12 there in a minute. So let us have pre-placed another brown stone there, and then we can get 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. And there, in a minute, we'll go 17. So each brown stone buys us five more steps. When we put down that brown stone, we were able to add 12, 13, 14, 15, and 16. And here we got 5, and here we got 5. So with n starting stones, n brown stones, this is not the best you can do, but it certainly shows that you can get at least 5n-4, because each time you add one more brown stone. So here, with two brown stones, we went up to 6. And if I put n equals 2, two brown stones, 5 times 2 minus 4 is 6. Three brown stones, we went up to 11.
And this thing's going in a straight line.
It's
not going to twist back on itself.
No, it's a zigzag. Yeah. So we just do in a zigzag like that and keep going. It's a very simple-minded construction, and I wouldn't be at all surprised if some ingenious person viewing this can come up with something that does wrap around itself and give a much better lower bound. But at least we know it grows linearly, 5n-4. Now, what about in the other direction? Can we put a limit on how many you can get? And for that, I need another piece of paper. Is there any limit to how many you can get if you've got three brown stones? What's the maximum possible you could ever hope to get? You might think you could get infinitely many. And the way I think of this is it's a kind of a mountain climbing problem. You want to get as high as you can, but in order to get to that height, you have to build steps up the mountain to get there. To get to height 31,000 up at Everest, you've got to have steps in the mountain that are labeled with all the numbers down to one, and the one being any one of the huts. I think of the brownstones as huts, brown being a good color because the huts are usually down on the ground. And the white, of course, corresponds to the ice, where you're cutting the steps, the snow fields that you're ascending. So let's suppose you could get to a very high point. And this argument from Robert Kibitz says, let's look at a really high point. Let's call it H. It's a square where we got very high up. How did we get there? Well, it's got eight neighbors. How could you get 100? To get 100, you must have had some pretty big numbers around it. You could have had, for instance, an 80 and a 20. We could have had a 50, a 49, and a 1. A 1 would be a hut, a brown stone. I want to argue that there must be a fairly small stone somewhere in the neighborhood. If there's a 1, so much the better. But there has to be a stone around it which is less than or equal to 50. In fact, less than or equal to 49, but never mind. If we've got an H here, one of these stones, I don't know which one, is less than or equal to H over 2. Because if all the stones around it were bigger than H over 2, we'd get a number bigger than H here. So one of the eight, at least one of the eight, has to be at most H over 2, a neighbor of this. Well, I'll look at the neighbors of that. The neighbor of this H over 2, one of them must be at least, at most, H over 4, say there. And a neighbor of that must be at most H over 8. And so after going D steps from this high point, there must be a square with at most H over 2 to the D. But if we go far enough, that's got to be a 1.
What's got to be a 1?
The small one you get to. The high point has to have a neighbor at most H over 2. A neighbor of that has to be at most H over 4. The neighbor of that at most H over 8. Each time we go one step further away, we can divide by another power of 2. So, for instance, to have a concrete example, I was going to use Everest. It's a little easier if I take 65,000. Suppose we could get up to 65,000. 65,000 is just less than 2 to the 16, which is 6, 5, 5, 3, 6. So I've picked a number here, just a bit under 2 to the 16. And so following this path, you're always taking the smallest neighbor. We will eventually get down to a 1 in at most 15 steps. So from here to here, so if it's 655, think that means within a radius of 15, there's a 1. There's a hut at one of our starting things. All right, so now let's suppose that we could get to 65,000 using just 3 1s. Let me prove that's impossible. So let's say we have our high point here, 65,000, twice as high as Everest. And within a square of side 15, within a square around it of size 31 by 31, there has to be a hut somewhere. So a brown, a starting stone. Let's suppose we were able to get to 65,000 with just 3 starting stones. Here's a starting stone, here's a starting stone, and here's a starting stone. And we know that somewhere within distance 15 of one of these 3 is the 65,000. So if I draw the squares around it of size 31, and around here of size 31, and around this one of size 31, inside one of these 3 squares of size 31 is our high point, is our point higher than Mount Everest, the 65,000. Is within one of these 3 squares. That's what I just proved. But that's going to be impossible, because not only do we have to get 65,000, we have to get all the numbers up to it. We have to get all the numbers in these squares. One, two, well, we've got the one. We have to get 2, 3, 4, all the way up to 6, 4, 9, 9, 9 before we can get to the top. It's not going to work, because inside this square, there are only 31 squared stones, less than 961, less than 1,000. So we've got 1,000 squares here, 1,000 squares here, 1,000 squares here. Total of at most 3,000 squares. On the other hand, we have to get 65,000 stones to get up there. So it's a contradiction. So you can't do it with three stones. Three stones are not enough to get to 65,000.
You can't create branches that come out of the squares and
no, because if there was a stone at 10,000, there still has to be a 1 within 10,000 divided by what the appropriate power of 2. They all have to be within the squares of side 31, centered at the 3 huts. Everything we do has to be within these 3 squares.
So what does that mean for our upper bound?
Our upper bound, yes. So what this actually gives, if you do it properly, is about n log n for the upper bound. But Robert Kubitz fine-tuned the argument, and taking care of what happens around the huts, the small numbers, doing that counting more delicately. And he proved, in fact, you can't get more than 714 n. If you have n huts, n brown stones, the highest you can get is 714 times n. So we know you can't get arbitrarily high.
But that initial sequence you showed me,
went up for 6 terms, yes.
And that wasn't 714 times n?
No, it's just an upper bound. He's just proving that you cannot hope to do any better, no matter how clever you are. In fact, you can't do anywhere near as well. But it's just a theoretical upper bound.
By 2, the answer is 0. What about a 3 by 3? If we put a black queen here, it attacks all the squares except these two. So we could put a white queen here. We could put a white queen here too, but we'd have two white queens, and we cannot put two black queens. So the numbers have to be equal, okay? All you can do is one of each color.